The next slot in our agenda carries a government health warning. The management takes no responsibility for what may happen next. Let's just say I'm handing over now to the Yellow Brick Roadies. And in charge of the Yellow Brick Roadies, I'm handing over to Vicky Mulvana. Vicky.
The great and powerful, who are you? Who are you?
We've come to ask you.
The great and powerful Oz knows you have come. Step forward, Vicky Mulvana. I'll grant your request on one condition. You must prove yourself by performing a small task. Bring the broomstick of the Witch of the West and tell me the story of the Fellowship Road.
Magic, eh? So my name is Vicky Mulvana, and I'm known in the North Cohort as the Mover and Shaker. No idea why. I'm a children's physiotherapist, an allied health professional, and proud of it. For my job, you need eyes in the back of your head, a stomach of iron, and no adverse reactions to snot. Oh, and a creative mind. So how did I get here to the fellowship? As all fellows here today, we let loose our creative minds, developed service improvement projects, and attended grueling panel interviews and presentations, and became the prestigious cohort of clinical fellows. I guess my interest in leadership started a few years ago when a new directorate manager in therapies was appointed. Seen by some as landing from Mars, with notions that leadership should be shared and adaptive, she set to create an environment that was open, where you had to ask for forgiveness rather than permission. It seemed a way of being for her, harder to adopt for others. And yet she collaboratively managed to create a shared vision for a therapy strategy. In fact, if it wasn't for her encouragement, I would have not chased small cat-sized dinosaurs around an imaginary hospital at the Allied Health Professionals Programme, or taken part in the Department of Health Services Improvement Programmes. She and the experiences have inspired me to become a better person and a better leader. I share this with the fellows. We applied for the fellowship because we aspire to be better, and together we can be. The fellowship has taken an enormous commitment, both on a personal level and of those who have supported us, our families, our teams and our organisations, the sponsors, and on behalf of the fellows, I would like to acknowledge the commitment and encouragement our sponsors have shown us throughout this programme and ongoing projects. Thank you. Now, for those who are more kind of observant than others, you may have noticed that a lot of fellows are wearing red shoes, or red attire, and that was deliberate because we wanted to bring the whole cohorts together. So, ladies and gentlemen, I would like you to stand. Now is good. Well done. Okay, I want you to put on your ruby slippers. Click your heels and feel the magic. Come on, click your heels, I can't see it. For I'm going to take you on a journey, our journey, for there's no place like home. I like this.
Close your eyes and tap your heels together 3 times. And think to yourself, there's no place like home. There's no place like home.
There's no place like home. There's no place like home.
Wake up, honey.
There's no place like home.
So where is home? Somewhere? Over the rainbow? No, teasing. Three cohorts. There should be some music on, I think. A mixture of professions. The Fellowship Service Improvement Projects have been used as vehicles to learn from and have had varying success. My project aligned personal therapist goals with patient goals, directorate and organisational strategy, aiming to charge patients with taking responsibility for their own healthcare and reducing wasted appointments. But enough about me. There's other projects as well, some of which you've had opportunity to look at earlier on the posters, but to name a few included implementation of robust clinical pathways in the ambulance service, integrated dental commissioning models, redesign and staff training programmes to name but a few. The Fellowship has provided a greater understanding of the political, economic and financial context in which we operate. It has enabled collaboration of a mixture of professionals across the NHS and allowed opportunity to share and learn and experience. Our behaviours, thoughts, feelings, academic abilities have been tested, broken down and rebuilt. If the intention was to foster a belief of shared adaptive leadership, it worked. I now feel like I'm part of the Borg. As a whole, the NHS must muster the courage, sharpen its critical thinking skills and develop the passion of putting patients first. But how do we whip up a storm to create an environment which teams think like we do? It starts here, with us, with you. We need to question assumptions and practice and share our learning. I am convinced that an archetype for almost any situation can be reflected in the film The Wizard of Oz, hence the theme. I know it sounds weird, but go with me for a while. You have to hand it to Dorothy, the main character of the story. She embarks on a journey and fully engages with the wonders, adventures, friendships and dangers she faces, but is never deterred from her true goal of finding her way home back to Kansas. Does your organisation have the clarity and purpose and vision? How, as you do, as a leader, do you keep yourself and your followers focused on that purpose? Exceptional teamwork derives from aligned what's in it for me. Everyone in the story needs to get to the Emerald City to see the wizard. The journey is safer and more productive travelling together. To this end, aligning personal needs and motivations of followers help us to keep the focus and goal. So let's meet the team. The Scarecrow. He thinks he has no brain, but in fact he's a highly reflective thinker. And given a little time, he produces amazing solutions to the problems. In fact, in the story, it's the Scarecrow that devises the answer to getting Dorothy out of the castle with the Wicked Witch. The Scarecrow becomes much smarter as he travels through Oz and with his comrades. At the end, he gets a degree, we get a certificate. But then credentials aren't everything, and it's how we use what we learn that's important. A man who knows all about learning and brains is Tim Atkins, professional lead consultant psychologist at Cumbria Partnership NHS Foundation Trust, who will talk to us with his presentation, If I Only Had a Brain. Tim.
Scarecrow there. Okay, hello, I'm Tim Atkin. I'm a clinical psychologist of 20 years and a family therapist of 10 years. So you might think I shouldn't have a problem with actually having a brain. But I'd never done a service improvement project before, so I was looking for some skills and knowledge that I really didn't think I had. I'm hoping to show you how the fellowship helped me find in myself the equivalent of the wizard's doctorate of thinkology, not just a degree, a doctorate, awarded to the Scarecrow at the end of the yellow brick road. I work in Cumbria Partnership Foundation Trust, which until April 2011 was a county-wide mental health and learning disabilities trust. Through transforming community services, the numbers in the trust more than doubled. And in children's services, they went from about 100 staff to over 500 staff. My project was to develop a training strategy for children's services. And the aim was to enable staff to deliver an excellent service and achieve best outcomes for children and families. Not that simple, for a few reasons, one of which was illustrated by this guy. Where's Herbie? This is from a slide from the Manchester Business School. Herbie was weighed down with the baggage while all the other scouts leapt up the mountain. And he illustrated the theory of constraints and the idea that you needed to identify the key constraints because they were the ones that limited progress. Herbie meant the scouts had to wait for him, limited their speed. But what would be the key constraints to limit my own project? Well, we identified two. The first wasn't money. The trust had set aside money to aid the integration of new staff through training. What was most limited was the time staff could spare from practice, from delivering the service to train. We had to prioritise. The second key constraint was clarity. It wasn't clear what commissioners wanted this new formed children's services to do. They were developing their commissioning priorities, so the project had to deal with abstract concepts and go from first principles. So how did the fellowship help me find the ability to lead this project? Well, like the Wizard of Oz pointed out to the Scarecrow, I had the solution within me, but only realized it when the fellowship showed me the way. The early focus on self-awareness, motivational, psychological factors in leadership meant I could access my own core skills as a psychologist. This is the table of MBTI types, which I think we're very, very familiar with. So how could I use my psychological skills? Well, at MBS, we encountered a guy called Simon Dodds and his ideas of three wins. And my project was already looking for a win for the organisation in terms of having staff trained for the job that they were to do. And a second win for the children and families in terms of the quality of the service they received. But Simon Dodds' third win was for staff. How do you create a win for staff in terms of morale and motivation? That was the psychological win that I hadn't been previously aware of. How was I to engage staff in change? When we went to Warwick, Catherine Holmes talked to us about the call to action, to engage people's emotions through their values. So I set out to engage staff's values and dedication, to enthuse them and make them feel supported by the trust, so that they could know, they could work knowing that the trust would help them do their best for patients. I decided to name my project Supporting Best Practice and sell it as enhancing, encouraging, and enabling staff to achieve their best potential. Now, you might see this as just a title or a motivational tool, but so was the way the wizard used his award of the Doctorate of Thinkology to the Scarecrow. And the feedback I got suggested it did its job and told people we were behind them, rather than trying to get them to comply, rather than trying to adopt a command and control position. The philosophy was to help staff discover their full potential, just as the wizard helped Scarecrow. Help Scarecrow discover his own abilities, including the ability to press a button, clearly. There were a number of elements to the project, but the framework developed to prioritise training needs probably best illustrates how I drew on the fellowship. In Warwick at the end of January, we had a good look at the Francis Report, and that made me know that safety and values must be the first priority. But in the King's Fund experiential work, that taught me to look at all aspects of quality. And it drew me towards thinking about the three aspects of quality that Darcy's report talks about, those of safety, effectiveness, and experience. How could I build those into my priorities for the project? Then at the Manchester Business School, Nathan Proudlove, who's not here today, so he won't be able to critique my explanation of this, described a Kano diagram to us. Now, a Kano diagram illustrates how the presence or absence of quality in a service influence or relate to customer satisfaction. So the higher you go on the Kano diagram, the more satisfied people are. The lower, the more, I love the word they use, disgusted customers are. The more to the left you go, the less quality is present. The more to the right you go, the more quality is present. I realised that the three areas described by this diagram split into three different elements of quality that fitted quite closely to the Darcy triad. So the first area is seen as essential or threshold or basic aspects of a service. So you might think about the brakes on a bike or the foundations of a house. The bits of a service you just can't do without, but the bits that customers, clients, patients don't notice unless they're really not there, and then they are absolutely, well, disgusted, or in the health service, terrified. For health services, this equates to safety, and so my first priority is to make sure all practice is safe. The second area on the Kano diagram is about performance. So the weight or the aerodynamic design of a bike, anything that makes performance improve, makes the customer more satisfied. Within children's services, the more skilled the practitioner, the more effective the practice. So it equated to effectiveness in the Darcy triad. And the third area is the delighters. So those things that aren't expected, those things that surprise us, extra gears on a bike. Yeah, my bike's got extra 20 gears. How do I work them? So the unexpected quality aspect might be excellence of experience, that actually we provide a service, but how can we make it an excellent experience? So these are all important aspects of quality, but if one has to prioritise them, which is one of my key constraints, then it seemed like the Kano diagram helped distinguish these priorities and justify them. This does suggest there is an order of priority to the DASI triad, but I guess that, I don't know whether that's a controversial point or not. This argument then meant that we could prioritise commissioning £15,000 worth of what we call governance training for community child health staff to address the safety of practice. But then we also identified how a nationally recognised package called the Solihull Approach aimed at training these staff in supporting children's emotional health and well-being could address all three training priorities, and so justify spending over £30,000 on training staff in this. Now, staff are enthusiastic to take this up. It's an area of work that health visitors and school nurses particularly feel least confident about when they come out of their professional training, because their training's taught them how to engage parents and children, but it hasn't helped them develop those skills to use this engagement to help people emotionally and psychologically, only physically. So many health visitors I've worked with have these skills, but don't know it. And the Solihull Approach is a great way to give them a framework to make sense of their existing knowledge and how to exploit it. And so we're back to the scarecrow, because he just needed to know that he could think. These staff just needed to know that they could use their existing skills. I just needed to know that I could use my knowledge and skills to lead a service improvement project. This guy was Vygotsky, a developmental psychologist who I learnt about a long time ago. And he would have said that what you need is the right scaffold to allow you to learn new skills. I like the more magical feel of having the right yellow brick road. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Tim. When I see you, I always want to say I'm off to see the wizard. You being a therapist and all. Said with some humour, but it has some significance, other than as a therapist, you're certainly no fraud behind the curtain. There are some telling parallels between The Wizard of Oz and mental health. Here to tell us more is Carol Hurst, Director of Psychological Therapies from Rotherham, Doncaster and South Humber Foundation Trust, with One in Four.
One in four people watched Usain Bolt win a gold medal in the 100 metres sprint. One in four people will, within any given year, experience a mental health problem. Four fictional characters: Dorothy, the Lion, the Scarecrow, and the Tin Man. In a little while, I will be exploring these four characters to see which one of those might be the one in four. But what does one in four look like? Can I ask you to feel on your chair? And some of you on the right-hand side will have a small piece of string tied to your chair. If this is you, can you remove it, please? And stand up. Don't be shy. Most of us don't know we're one in four. But if the three people you're with don't have it, it's you. Ladies and gentlemen, this is what one in four looks like. One in four fellows, one in four faculty, one in four sponsors, one in four. Thank you. You can sit down, but hold on to the string. I'm Carol Hurst, and I'm Director of Psychological Therapies for RDASH, and I am very, very proud to be employed by the NHS and to be a public servant. And I really am I really want to stress that's what I feel I am, a public servant. I'm very proud of it. I'm very proud of my organisation that has said very clearly that it wants to encourage clinical leaders and has supported me in this fellowship. And I'm very, very proud to represent the Northern Cohort and all of the fellows in telling you about my project, which is around mental health. I was going to refer to my cohort as the beautiful people, but having heard this morning that we've gone beyond all that silly envy stuff, I decided not to. Okay, I'm all grown up now, honest. Until tonight in the disco. Okay, so my project was improving services for people with chronic depression, and I want to differentiate chronic depression. And I'm hijacking this, I'm going to be perfectly honest, because in this room there's such a huge, wide representation from the NHS of leaders, influencers, and in the fellows, movers and shakers from every discipline. So I am making no apologies. I want all of you to go away with new awareness about mental health, and particularly about chronic depression, which I'll explain a bit more about. So one in four people have a mental health problem. The most common mental health problem of all is depression. Now, depression. We've done really well in this country, actually, improving our services for depression. We've had guidance come out from NICE that we're all following, aren't we? And we've had the Improving Access to Psychological Therapies programme that some of my colleagues here today represent. And that's done amazing things to improve services for the huge amounts of people who are suffering with depression in our country. We've also got really good at recognising chronic, long-term conditions, physical conditions, and managing them much better, and actually realising that we need to teach patients and people, because that's what they are, who have these diseases, to be able to self-manage, because they're chronic and very often lifelong. We've missed a trick, though, because what we haven't really understood in terms of our pathways and our guidance is that depression very often itself is a long-term condition that begins invariably in childhood, can last a lifetime, and has a massive, massive impact on individuals, families, and the healthcare system and the economy. Huge, huge. 3% of our population we know have chronic depression, dysthymia, which is mild but very disabling. And this is staggering. It takes, on average, 10 years for people to get treatment. 10 years. And that chronic depression eats away at people, at their ability to study, their ability to work, their ability to parent, and all of that stuff. So when you go along to your doctors and he will ask you, because we've done so well in recognising depression, he should be asking you about depression if you've got a long-term physical condition. What we're not asking is, how long have you been like this? Because it might be mild, and the doctor looks at NICE guidance and says, oh, mild depression, don't do anything, a bit of watchful waiting. Until if he asked them, well, how long have you felt like this? And they said, well, actually, since I was about 5, or I can never remember feeling any other way than this. And that's very common. We know that from scientific, rigorous, empirical, Jeff, research, okay, that tells us that. And so now I'm going to turn to the four characters, and I'm going to go through them one by one, and we're going to see which one of our four characters, there they are, Nelly sat on your knee, Tim. Four characters. Okay, let's start with Dorothy. Dorothy. Thank you to Tim's daughter who sent these for me to play with. Dorothy, okay? Dorothy had childhood trauma. She was swept away from her home by a violent storm. Again, what we know from rigorous research is that people with early onset chronic depression, and commonly it is early in childhood, have experienced some form of abuse or trauma. Very often not kind of big trauma, but ongoing neglect, psychological insults on a daily basis, not being nurtured, okay? So, unfortunately, people with depression very often, unlike Dorothy, never find their way home. The Tin Man. It's so lovely. I want an outfit like this. The Tin Man had no heart, okay? Now, I think you all know this. People with depression find it very hard to experience pleasure. We call it anhedonia. Perhaps you don't know that people with depression also find it difficult to feel sad. They actually will talk about feeling that they're behind a metaphorical wall that separates them from the world, from other people, even from their loved ones. And so for people with depression, emotion just very often isn't there. Tin Man, the Scarecrow, okay. He didn't have a brain, as we've heard, and depression is a disease of the brain. Okay, neuroscience has been able to show us that the brains of people with depression are different to the brains of people without depression at a cellular level. What's interesting is, on a cellular level, it's like a relational level. Anyway, I won't go there. It's fascinating, though. And the part of the brain, it is honest, the part of the brain that deals with emotion, when people are depressed, it shrinks. But here's the good news. With effective treatment and for chronic depression, that's medication and psychotherapy, it grows again. What better reason for us to improve services for people with chronic depression? My favourite character of all, and I think this character tells us more about depression than any of the other three. The lion lacked courage. People with depression lack the courage to engage with life. For them, making a phone call to someone they love can demand enormous courage. Getting up in the morning and going to work for those who can hold down a job, and many of them can, and as Ruby Wax says, they make excellent employees, people with chronic depression, because they pour everything into their jobs. So, lacking courage. For some people with chronic depression, courage fails them, and they exit. They choose suicide. Suicide is higher among people with low levels of chronic depression than it is with major depressive disorder. And courage, it's really important. Please never say to anyone with depression, pull yourself together, because they can't. But you can help them pull themselves together by effective treatment, and that's where my project comes in. 1 in 4, we've actually got 4 in 4, but imagine all of those things in one person. It's really difficult and really hard. And what I noticed as a therapist, having trained in several modalities of therapy, practicing therapy for many years, considered myself a very good therapist, people with chronic depression, I just couldn't get them better. I just couldn't, you know, they were getting insight and they could understand things, but they weren't getting any better. So I discovered through research, because I'm doing a PhD in chronic depression, there was a treatment called Cognitive Behavioral Analysis System of Psychotherapy, which is an absolutely diabolical name, but a very good therapy. So I went off to America because you couldn't train in England in this therapy. So I went off to America because of the fellowship. The professor came from America to our region, to Doncaster. They weren't going to let him in the country, but hey! Came to Doncaster and trained therapists from across our region. Next week, we see the second training program funded by the SHA for therapists across our region to learn how to do this therapy. The clinical outcomes we're getting from this group of patients who very often go, if they're diagnosed, go untreated, can now have CBASP. And next week we're launching the UK network. Please, can you pick up your pieces of string? And can you tie a knot in them? You are absolutely influential in your areas, and you work everywhere from dentistry to surgery to pharmacy, everything, everybody. Very influential. Sponsors, academia, King's Fund. Just hold that string up with a knot in it. Okay, Forget me not, please don't forget the one in four. Thank you.
Are your synapses jumping? Mine are. Next up, Katie Young, healthcare scientist, Royal Devon and Exeter NHS Foundation Trust, with Knowledge Speaks, Wisdom Listens.
Hello, my name's Katie. I currently work at the Royal Devon and Exeter Hospital, but when I undertook the fellowship, I was actually working at Taunton and Somerset NHS Trust. I'm one of the four healthcare scientists who are in the cohort of clinical fellows this year. My title of my presentation is Knowledge Speaks, but Wisdom Listens. And I'd like to thank Lorraine very much for the excellent Jimi Hendrix quote, which kind of fitted with my presentation quite nicely, actually. So thank you, Lorraine. I'd also like to say thank you to everyone who supported me through the course of the fellowship. And that's to my fellow fellows, and also to the faculty, and to everybody, really, just to say thank you very much for the opportunity. So this is my way of saying thank you, really. Okay, so this is a whistle-stop tour of everything that I've learnt during the course of the fellowship, neurophysiology style. So I hope nobody minds a little bit of science. Okay. So when I first started the fellowship, this was me. I felt slightly inept at my job, I guess. I was working as a deputy service lead. People were coming to me with problems, and I wasn't quite sure exactly how I was supposed to deal with them, and I didn't really always have the answers. And it made me feel worse about what I was doing because I didn't feel like I was doing a particularly good job. But one of the sort of biggest things that I've learned, really, that makes me feel so much better is that actually I don't need to know all of the answers, and leadership isn't about knowing all of the answers, but it's about asking the right questions. And that people have the answers within themselves already. And during the course of the fellowship, we've done an awful lot of work on systems thinking and how making a small change in a system can actually have very big changes elsewhere that perhaps you weren't quite anticipating. And I'd like to talk a little bit about system thinking in the context of our brain, because we have one of the probably the most complex systems in the world within each and every one of us. And brains are pretty cool bits of kit. A piece of brain tissue the size of a grain of sand contains 100,000 neurons and 1 billion synapses. Now that's a pretty big system. And for a big system to carry on functioning like it should do, it needs to communicate. And effectively, all of the cells, that should be a video, but I don't think it's working. it is. All of the cells within our brains, our neurons, before they actually send an action potential to the relevant parts of the body asking it to perform a task, it actually listens to inhibitory and excitatory synapse potentials, which are upon each neuron. And for an action potential to be generated, the amount of excitatory potentials has to outweigh the inhibitory ones. So essentially, our cells are listening to all the other cells around them to try and decide on an action. And when the system's functioning normally, this is what we would see. This is an adult resting EEG, very, very normal, beautiful alpha rhythm. sorry. This is a system failure, as it were. This is a seizure. And there is a theory behind seizure generation that there's a loss of inhibition in our synapses. So the inhibitory synapse potentials aren't recognized. So the excitatory ones go a little bit mad. And then we have a seizure. So I think it demonstrates really the need to have lots of different people in your team as well, because you need to have that balance between people who are very positive about service improvement and those who are sort of looking at saying, oh, hang on a minute, that might not work as well as you think it will, and to actually put all of everybody's views together to be able to decide a way forward. I'm going to quote Simon Dodds again. Simon Dodds, in his book, The Three Winds, told us an awful lot about collecting data, and data can be collected on many, many different parts of a system. The time that you wait between a referral to test, the staff that actually carry out the tests, all sorts of things. You can collect data on an awful lot of different things. And Simon Dodds said that there are many different types of data that can be collected, and virtually all of these will be useful at some stage. So it's worth adopting this good habit early, which I didn't, and regretted it. unfortunately, we had the lecture a little bit after I'd done the data collection bit, so... we learned an awful lot as well about tools and service improvement models, change management techniques. And one of the things that I picked up about tools was that not every tool is actually functional for the purpose that you're trying to use it. And sometimes I did try and shoehorn a few tools in where perhaps they weren't that useful. And Tachi Ono, the developer of the famous Toyota production system, did not wish to codify the process that he'd designed, as he felt that it would ossify it into a trivial set of tools. So he felt that the people on his production line had the innovation to be able to come up with ideas themselves, and he didn't want to solidify that into a tool. And I think that's something that I've really sort of picked up on. Finally, I make a lot of mistakes. mistakes are inevitable, and I've realised that mistakes aren't necessarily a bad thing, and there's a lot that we can actually learn from mistakes, and also we can let other people know about our mistakes so that they don't have to have a mistake too. So mistakes aren't necessarily a bad thing, and next time you make a glaring error, you can blame it on your inhibitory synapse potentials. Thank you.
Okay, so you may think, we're going to have opportunity for questions, but you may think, why have I got a ball in my hand? Well, as a paediatric physio in charge of this, I could only go to the normal routes and become a paediatric physio for this section. So in my hand is what we call a roaming microphone, and I'm going to throw it out to you guys to ask the questions. Okay? So whoever gets it has to ask one. Just kick us off. Oh! Seriously. Go on, you could.
Well, I haven't got any questions actually, so I'm part of the cohort.
I thought you would have questions, which is why I threw it towards you.
Well, I thought there was a cue to.
Not yet, later.
Okay.
Is there anybody else who has questions for these guys?
I'm all right.
Remember, there was a disclaimer at the beginning of this.
Hello, does it work? Yeah, I'm Charlotte again, sorry about that, I didn't ask this time. Can each of you tell us a bit more about some of the challenges that you've faced in your projects, please? Does Tim want to go
first?
That's
a very open
question.
You've
got the mic.
I guess the schedule of when we did the projects and when we had the... When we had the inspiration of the training, so the for example the Kano diagram, I was inspired to come up with the Kano diagram on the 24th of July. Does that means something to the fellows because the reports were in on the 23rd of July, yeah. So it's a course of. It will be a lifetime regret that I could not put that in my report.
One of the challenges that I realised was that actually I was trying to change culture with my my project, and it was a lot more difficult than what I thought it would be because I thought that people would be knocking down the door to come along to a sort of a same-day service. But actually, on our first day, I was sat there twiddling my thumbs, thinking, "Where is everybody?" and it sort of—I think it took me a while to realise that it would take some time for a service to get off the ground, and I was kind of expecting it to happen a little bit more overnight than that, but it didn't.
Very briefly, two challenges for me. One was
Well, neither of them were really challenges in terms of getting the job done, because I think I kind of got those skills, but I think that they've definitely improved. But for me, the biggest challenge was myself. I learned some things about myself that I was quite shocked at. You know, I thought I was, you know, very insightful. I've had years of therapy, and I've been an ass for my money back then. So for me, the challenges were really letting what I was learning in and coming to terms with what I was seeing. That and I think that was probably for me the biggest challenge.
Does anyone want the mic?
Any other questions? Just down here at the front, throw the ball carefully, please.
Hi, I'm Helen Anderson. I'm really interested because I've been on leadership courses. I've had staff who've been on leadership courses, and I think all too often at the end, you go back to the workplace and you haven't got that support around you anymore, and you haven't got that programme to work to, and it sort of dissipates quite quickly. And I just wonder, what's the next step for you? Because this has been a fantastic thing for me. I'm not a sponsor, I'm a guest. I've come in rather late in it, but this seems the most fabulous programme you've been through. What's the next thing that's going to make sure that your skills and the things you've learned remain embedded in your organisation so we continue to benefit from these fantastic projects?
Well, to quote the film, it's in our, it's us to do it, I think is probably the best answer I can give. We've got the skills and we've got the opportunity to use them, so I suggest as fellows, that's exactly what we do. Some people have already gone out and got new jobs, different recognition, and they should be commended for that. But it's about us making a difference and taking that next step and saying we're here, let's be used.
So my supplementary question then is, what would you want your organisation to do to enable you to be used?
Well, I think I'm being used already.
Can we all come
up? 8A in the pocket there. No, no, but I think it's about having the opportunity and being in an environment that allows you to do what you do best, which is be a clinical leader. I think that's how I would answer that. Anybody have comments?
Yeah, I was going to say, I think we've been very fortunate over the course of the fellowship, because of the length of time that it's run, a lot of the things that we've learned have become sort of quite embedded. And to help sort of continue that, we're carrying on our action learning sets, which I think is going to be really, really useful. So that's one thing that we're doing sort of proactively to try and sort of keep that at the forefront of our minds. But again, mirroring what you're saying, having an organisation that supports emerging clinical leaders, so not someone who's sort of head of department or anything like that, but from within a team to kind of grow and flourish.
Thank you.
Okay. Any more questions?
Can I just say that I think from our organisation, I think there's two things. For me personally, I've recognise that this will dissipate and go if I don't keep the momentum going, and I'm going to keep the momentum going on a personal level through coaching, and which I found absolutely, you know, really useful in terms of being able to work through some of those difficulties I mentioned earlier. But I think as well it's about organisations having clinical leadership on their agendas at every level of the organisation, and I think that's what we need organisations and sponsors to do, and you know, so that we can recognise emerging leaders and start coaching them. And you know, thankfully for my organisation, that is one of our three priorities.
Time for one more at the front here. Needs work on proprioception.
Actually, that good lady over there asked both the two questions I was itching to ask, but I think it's incredibly important. I'm Suzanne Khalid from University Hospitals of Leicester. Claire's sponsor for the programme. But it's, as well as you individually taking responsibility to share what you've learnt within an organisation, it's really about what the sponsor and the organisation can do to allow you and enable that, because my concern is there's a risk it could get lost, and that would be a huge loss for the NHS. So there's something for me when I go back to Leicester about how we can platform Claire's work across the organisation, and I'd encourage other sponsors here present to do that. So just as you've said there, about how you can coach and network with other people who've got a passion for service improvement and great leadership.
Thank you. Okay. Moving on then. Next up, thank you. Time to meet another member of the team now, the lion. In the story, he lacks courage. Oh, it's me, sorry. Well, sit back down, I'll do it again. Are we ready? I'll try again. Okay, next up, the Tin Man. He thinks he... he thinks he isn't heartless and cruel in that sense of the word. That's the physiotherapists, and that's another story. But he simply lacks will and doesn't have the heart to do things anymore. The Tin Man's focus on the fear of failing actually prevents him from doing anything at all. He cares and worries about everything until he sheds tears and rusts. Who are the Tin Men in your organisation? All Heart is Lorraine Major, Paediatric Advanced Nurse Practitioner from Hampshire Hospital NHS Foundation Trust with Learn to Trust Your Heart.
Hi, everybody. I was once working with one of my colleagues, and she said to me, and I do venipuncture on children, and I said to I said to one of my patients, I'm sorry, my hands are really cold, really cold. And the mum said, oh, don't worry, cold hands, warm heart. And my colleague said, she has no heart. Now, this is what my head felt like on this course. It was absolutely crammed packed, and to say that I did get headache trying to construct those assignments was an understatement. But I'm here to work on the heart, and it's huge and enormous, and for me, I would like to relay some stories which were very relevant to me in relation to hearts. So this is me in Uganda looking very stressed. In those two pink bags are twin girls. The mother had had eclampsia. She'd been whammed full of diazepam with quite a whacking big overdose. And so the two twin girls came out very flat and not breathing. The week before, I had been showing the nurses who were standing looking over me how to do neonatal resuscitation. And not one of them participated when the babies were given to me by the consultant. Now, if you look behind the babies, there's actually nobody there. The anaesthetist has left, the patients have left, and everybody else who was supporting with the C-section that these babies were born with have gone home. I bagged these babies for 4.5 hours because I knew eventually the diazepam would wear off in the time. So Alex, where were you when I needed you? In the time, I thought, well, there must be an antidote. So somebody drove into the town, went to the pharmacist, came back, stuck his head round the door and said, you're just going to have to bag longer. And when I was finished, this was then the next day, looking very pink and very alive and very nice. And when I was finished, one of the anaesthetists came to me and she said, why did you do that? Why did you bag them for 4.5 hours? And I really, really had to sort of think and say, well, why not? Why would you not have decided? And she says, oh, we'd have given them 10 minutes. 10 minutes, and then that would have been it, that would have been done. And it really made me think and reflect of what I valued and what was at what I believed. This is another story. This is Freddie, who was born to a Ugandan mother who'd had 6 pregnancies, no live babies, and he was one of twins. He's born at 32 weeks. Again, I am not a neonatal nurse. I'm a paediatric nurse. I don't do neonates. So when this baby was handed to me, and I took one look at him, there'd been a very traumatic birth. He came out, took a long time to come out. The incision wasn't big enough. The first twin who was smaller was dead. He was yanked by his feet, so he was navy blue from the knees down. And I had took him over and I took one look at him and I thought, holy shit. So I wrapped him up, I put him in one of those bags, and I immediately phoned my consultant at home. And I said, what do I do with a 32-weeker? She says, okay, Lorraine, what you have to do is you get him in an incubator, you get an IV infusion in, you start him on antibiotics, you give him oxygen, you get a nasogastric tube down him, and you start him on some formula. You check he's not hypoglycemic, and you just watch and wait. So I wrote it all down on my piece of paper. I came off the phone, and I turned round, and I thought, well, I don't have an incubator. I'm certainly not putting a line in a 32-weeker. Where do I get formula? It costs you £25 from the supermarket. What am I going to do with this baby to help him live? This was him 2 weeks later. And what that taught me was not only do you have to look at your beliefs and values, but you have to use the resources you have available to you at that particular time. We're never going to have enough money. We're never going to have enough time. We're never going to have enough staff. We have to look at what we have, and we have to look at what we can do with what is the particular time. So for me, my incubator was water bottles filled up with warm water. I did put a nasogastric tube down him, but then doing 24/7 care in Uganda is really tiring. So eventually I took it out because I was scared that he would either aspirate or he would get an obstructive bowel. And I let his mother feed, and please, no research associated, but 32-weekers do feed. And they lap, and they take small amount of milk frequently. Then he got jaundice. His feet cleared up, and he looked really well. So this was his phototherapy. So this was him half an hour in the morning and half an hour in the evening. I have to say that I have gained a huge amount of knowledge on the fellowship. Skills, how tools and techniques, how to deal with difficult conversations, and how to look at myself. And of all the knowledge I possess, everyone can have, but what I am and what I believe and what I value is all mine. And that's what I have to take forward on my journey every single day. This is another lady I have a huge amount of respect for. She does look like my Auntie Nan, but actually she's not. So this is Rosa Parks. And Rosa Parks was the lady in Alabama who one day just got on a bus for the civil rights movement and refused to get up. She just sat down, she sat in the seat where the white people should have sat. The driver came to her and says, you have to get up, there's a white person coming on the bus. And she just refused. Because afterwards, when she was interviewed, and even though she'd worked for the civil rights movement for years and she was a secretary, she just said, I was tired. I'd had enough. And I was going to make a difference. The pastor who actually lived in her village was Martin Luther King. She was the person who actually got him talking. 381 days later, the bus company was going bust because nobody boarded the buses. She was a hugely influential, tiny little lady who one day just stood up for her beliefs and her values and decided to make a difference. So this chap here, Simon Sinek, I learned this from looking at working with the Birmingham and Manchester school. He actually, we were taught what to do. We were given huge of tools and techniques of how to do it. But we really, really have to look at why we do it. Why do we put up with long hours? Why do we put up with multiple changes? Why do we turn up every single day, break appointments, don't pick up our children from school in time, cancel birthdays, and all those things that we do on a regular basis? Every single one of us does it. And I have to say, that's the most inspiring thing I find about working in the NHS, that I look around me and every single day I see examples of people who do amazing stuff, and they do it because of the why. They don't do it for the what, they don't do it for the how, they do it because of the why. So Dorothy said, if you ever go looking for your heart's desire, you don't have to look any further. In other words, your roots and your beliefs are what are really important, and they're with you all the time, as was demonstrated earlier in the videos. So we need our values, we need our beliefs. The givers are thoughts, okay? We act them out in our feelings, and whether that's a bit like myself, who gets terribly passionate and confrontational about my feelings and beliefs, or whether you're able to construct them in a really nice manner, but they activate your decisions. They make they actually make your decisions and what pushes you forward to actions and results. This was an amazing, I've just found this tipping point curve was absolutely amazing, because all of a sudden, when we were shown this, I realised that actually, do you know what? I don't have to convince everybody. I only have to convince a small amount of people, and I call them my fire starters, who will run with my flame, who will act and believe the same as I do, who have the same values as I do, and will be picking it up early and run with it and take it to the end. If we can work it ourselves, we have the power to change our team. We have the power to look at our entire organisation. And I ask the political sector to really deep down and look back at what the NHS beliefs and values are. Because if not until they do that, will they actually look at and realise what changes they're actually asking us to make. So effective leaders have the ability to constantly move themselves. And that's what I have learned from the fellowship altogether, is that it starts with me, but it has a lovely drop pond effect. And you can filter it out, and you can move it forward, and you can, and it's the invisible forces that shape us. It's the things that we don't talk about. It's the things that we don't see. It's the things that we don't really discuss. I don't really remember asking either Jeff or MD to ask me why I was doing my project. I got hot, well, how, and I got what, but I never got why. And this is what I love about children. So there's a little boy coming home from school, and he says to the teacher, "I found a dead cat." And she says, "How did you know it was dead?" He says, "Because I pissed in its ear." She says, "You what?" He says, "Yes." I leaned over and I went, "Psst," and it didn't move. Thank you very much.
How do I follow that? The lion. In the story, he lacks courage. He turns out to be a coward until he confronts numerous trials, challenges, learns self-confidence and bravery along the way. Don't be afraid. Realise right now that you're probably going to fail. Many of you, all of the time. It doesn't matter. But it's often from the depths of weakness and failure that we learn most from. Do you recognise your constant performers and the work of your organisational lions? I'll leave that question for you. But here to talk to us now is the Deputy Manager of Wheelchair Services and Occupational Therapy, Julie Burden, who will give us a personal account of the fellowship and her local stroke pathway.
Ladies and gentlemen, fellow fellows, I'm Julie Burden, and I'm an occupational therapist by background, and I work for the South Warwickshire Foundation Trust. I would never usually volunteer to give a presentation, particularly to an audience such as this, but this hasn't been a usual year for me. When I heard the themes were going to be brains, heart, and courage, I was compelled to share with you my personal story of the fellowship and my project. I've chosen to speak to you about courage. There have been a number of occasions in the last year when I've really questioned my competence, my resilience, and my influence. A year ago, I agreed to be part of the stroke development project for the Trust, and I have led on the service delivery models pathway, with particular reference to the modelling and development of an early supported discharge service. About a year ago, the project team met with staff, patients, management, and local stroke specialist stakeholders to explore the potential for service developments and make plans for a new service. I listened to staff who spoke passionately about their service. I listened to users and carers and patients who told of their own personal tales of suffering and I listened to senior management who gave commitment to service improvement and development. As a leader, a new leader, I was keen to put into place the theory of change management. I was really keen to listen to everyone, to include everyone, to make sure I communicated with everyone. What I hadn't anticipated was how many different variables there are that affect leadership in the workplace. Balancing a day job on top of new project management. The different priorities that the organisation have to those that are being voiced at the ground level. And being thrown in at the deep end with strategic meetings and senior management who, quite frankly, speak a different language. I was really fortunate in that I was given an opportunity to participate in strategic regional planning meetings that were going to radically shape the future of service provision for stroke pathway across the county. I listened in those meetings and I contributed to discussions about financial rationale and business security for organisations. I was really struck, however, at how many times the patient was referred to in the context, and not in the context of quality of care, but in the context of an occupied bed or a tariff. There have been many times during my project that I felt like a pawn in a much wider strategic game of chess. On occasions, I felt like the little lone voice for the patient. Questions that popped into my head on a regular basis. How does this benefit the patient? Is this really what the patient wants? I would like to introduce you to someone very special to me. This is Jill. She's my best friend and my mum. On the 30th of December last year, shortly after I'd met with the local stroke teams, my mum had a massive stroke and we were told that she wouldn't survive the weekend. We gathered the family together and we said our goodbyes, and it was the hardest thing I've ever done. But my mum is a fighter, and thanks to the NHS, she is still with us today. But she has a cognitive... She's been left with a complex cognitive and physical disability. Throughout her long and slow recovery, there have been many occasions when we battled against the system, we battled against bureaucracy, and we battled against lack of resources, just to get her the care that she needed and was entitled to. We had to become her voice. I had never anticipated when I signed up to the fellowship a year ago that I would have to go through this experience. But I have to say, given the ironic timing, it's given me a very different perspective and a very personal insight into stroke care and the National Health Service. Given my personal and professional experiences over the last year, I now understand that a pawn I may be, but every piece on that chessboard has a crucial part to play in moving the game forward. The art of leadership is being aware and seeing the bigger picture, but having the courage to stand up, speak out, and influence the pathway forward. I'd really like to thank my trust for giving me the opportunity to experience the bigger picture. I'd like to thank the Fellowship for giving me the confidence and the tools to fulfil my role. But mostly, I thank my mum for giving me the courage to be that lone voice for the patient, to challenge every question, every decision, and remind us all why we do what we do. Thank you.
Question time again. Is there any questions for our brilliant speakers? Go on, you know you want to. Was the food good on the fellowship? Did you go to the pub? Nothing?
It's not actually a question.
Comments are fine too.
It's not actually a question, as you can probably tell by my voice. You've very affected me quite deeply with your honesty and your passion about patients, and I think that's absolutely essential that we keep talking, especially at the moment, about patients all the time, whenever we have an opportunity. And we do forget when we're in more senior positions sometimes to use those words about people, as the person who was speaking before mentioned. I just want to say thanks very much for sharing those very, very powerful stories and bringing patients into the room. Thank you.
Ridwan?
Well, I suppose it's a question, but it's an opportunity to highlight certain aspects of the fellowship itself. Maybe it is expected that most, or maybe all the fellows on the program are passionate people about why they do their clinical work and that they want to make a difference. So that obviously was there from the beginning. My question is to both of you, which aspect of the fellowship program has now made you a different leader at the end of the fellowship? Or is it the set of tools that you've come across? Is it something more sort of personally deep? Or what exactly in the fellowship program has made you a different passionate clinician, a different sort of person who knows why they do their work? Thank you.
Well, I think probably for me, it's been a bit more constructive in my passion, and that being able to see a niggle, recognise that actually I can collect a bit of data, I can make a change, collect another little bit of data, and move it forward with that, and not just be moaning about it or expect it to be someone else's responsibility, or my manager's responsibility, or my organisation's responsibility, that actually that niggle, which again, I think we've all been very influenced by Simon Dodd, is that to say, you, what is it about in your everyday practice that makes you either get cross or it frequently occurs, and you take that niggle and move forward. It has given me the courage to do that, to be able to speak in the correct language and move it forward.
I think for me it's about understanding myself and getting a much greater self-awareness and confidence. I think I came into the fellowship wondering how I'd managed to get into this position. And by the end, when the emails went out about asking people to present, I really felt, well, that's not me, I don't do that sort of thing. Until actually I reflected back on everything that we've been through, and it's all about having the confidence to actually step out of your comfort zone and sometimes take a bit of a risk and go ahead and do it. And I think that's one of the biggest things I'll take away from this. Actually, it doesn't matter if you get it wrong sometimes, because you just have a go and have the confidence to give it your all.
I just want to say something. I was speaking to Sarah earlier on today, Sarah, and she said, which I thought was very apt, that we all have the qualities. They're all there. What the fellowship has done for it is buff us and polish us up and has allowed us to shine. So thanks for that, Sarah.
Thank you, that was brilliant. Okay, so they say that adversity builds character. Adversity also reveals character, and we've seen that on the stage today so far. And the journey that they all went through, they found what they were looking for, except Dorothy. She still wasn't home. So Glinda, the good witch, turns up again. And she said, and what does she tell Dorothy to do? Oh, good heart. Oh, good, good, good. And say, there's no place. Very good. Okay. So disappointed Dorothy says, if all I have to do is click my heels and say there's no place like home, why didn't you tell me that at the start of the film? Think of the CIPs we could have saved with only making a minute-long film. Why did I have to go through that journey? And Glinda says, you must go through the journey to find out that you had it in you all along. Adversity and the journey revealed her true character. She had it in her all along. The same can be said for our fellowship journey. And now we're moving on to our reflective kind of section of presentations. I'd like to welcome to the stage Ray Wong, consultant rheumatologist from Southend Hospital, and newly appointed, as of this week, Head of Social Work and Safeguarding, Jemima Burnage, from St.
Thanks, Vicky. So Jemima and I would like to just give you a quick sketch of our cohort journey rather than our individual journey. And it started, I think, as a bit of a magical mystery tour. When we applied, there was actually very little information about what the course would actually be. It was apply for this leadership course. Okay, here we go. As part of the application process, we had to come up with a project that would contribute towards a quip agenda, produce something that would, at the end of the day, improve quality of service of patients and save some money. And then we had this amazing online mathematical quiz, you may remember, all about hard data and numbers. And then we had an interview where half of it was about our project. What would we do? What were we hoping to achieve with our project? And it was about coming up with the goods, really. So I think most of us approached the course as we were heading towards it as something that would give us a set of tools, a management toolkit, how we could influence people better, how we'd get our projects done, how we'd make changes, how we'd be able to persuade people how right we were and they should do what we said. And then 3 weeks before the actual first module, or 2 weeks for the North cohort, we got this thing from Tracy Notches saying, oh, it's residential. and suddenly the fellows were scrolling about shift work, childcare, looking after the dogs, what's going on here? And by the way, there's a postgraduate certificate. So I think as a cohort, all of us ended up the Lane End Conference on our first day really not knowing what we were doing, where we were going, what it was all about. A state of rather complete confusion. And then we met each other. And as you can see, we're a hugely colourful bunch. Hideously diverse. And it was amazing how many different kinds of people work in the NHS. From a professional point of view, we had one of nearly everything. So we had one pharmacist and one physio and one audiological scientist and one cognitive behavioural therapist and one OT and one speech and language therapist, one GP, one surgeon, our star catch, our one social worker in the village. And very rapidly, of course, we found actually, apart from these professional differences, we differed in lots and lots of other ways, which Arma and Sally and Nick will go on to talk about. So we all met up. We didn't know who we were. We didn't know each other. We didn't know what we were supposed to be doing. So if we were so different, what did we actually have in common? People have talked about the imposter syndrome. I think a lot of us, we looked at the yearbook, we looked up each other up on Google, and we thought, oh, you know, what am I doing in this sort of company? All these fellows, these stars, established and rising. I think a lot of us felt really, do I deserve to be here? And then we went to Warwick, and the setup there with all the speakers, Secretary of State, Chief Executive of the NHS. I think a lot of us felt really unsure of ourselves. You know, did we deserve to be here? You know, did we deserve all the money spent on us? So that was one thing that I think that a lot of us had in common. But one thing we also had in common was curiosity. What was it all about? Why was the Leadership Academy doing this? You know, what were we going to find out? And the other thing I think that we had was optimism. You know, there was this huge challenge coming up. We knew there'd be a huge amount of work to do. Fairly quickly, we learned from our King's Fund and academic faculty that you know, we're going to have to do an awful lot of work academically and looking into ourselves and working with each other. But we were, I think, as a cohort, fairly optimistic that we could get through it, that we would survive, that we would thrive, that we would learn. Now, that may be optimism due to ignorance, self-confidence, maybe a bit of arrogance, but we were, as a cohort, confident that actually we could take it on. And so in the end, we said, well, resources or not, stretched or not, is a big job. Let's take it on.
Thank you, Ray. So our thing was really, it's about discovering new worlds. That's what our fellowship journey was about. We trod new ground. We had new experiences. We walked in people's shoes. We had the insight of other learned people around the country who told us about their experience and helped us to grow as leaders. We had lots of laughter too. That was a really important aspect, I think, of the fellowship and probably throughout the different cohorts. We had to learn to laugh ourselves and with each other as well to support each other on our journey. We had humility. That was really important to us too, about being authentic, about being us, about laying bare about who we were and what we might want to be. We became the learner and not the learned. We all came from experts in our field. We all had delivered services. We all came with expertise. And what we had to do was relearn that, lay that to one side, and actually start again, start to rebuild ourselves and look at what we could learn for the future to help us. So we had to be open and we had to accept ourselves for who we were and that we might change throughout this programme. That ended up with lots of tears. We did have tears, both in our action learning sets and at different points through the fellowship journey. But this was about sometimes about learning and development and our personal journeys being painful. Sometimes we didn't like what we saw along our self-development journeys. It wasn't always an attractive sight for each of us. But sometimes that was about looking inwards and actually saying, but that's okay. That's part of my own development and that's who I am. So the tears were a good thing, not just a bad thing. See, Mr. Bump, we had a few bumps, and for the NHS, there were a few slips, trips and falls, like we have. But mistakes are okay too. We made them, and we came back from them. And actually, what we'd do as a group and a cohort is support each other around our mistakes. We'd have discussions, we'd do our Google groups, we've got an online community. And we'd talk about them and learn from those mistakes to do better the next time. Most of all, important about our new experience was coming out of our protective shells, allowing each other to grow, and importantly, being vulnerable. So this was our mindfulness. We had a session of mindfulness, which for our cohort brought a few smiles. People had to really think, is this for me? Can I do this? I'm a bit embarrassed. We had feathers, people that were there and experienced it. Some of us had done it before, for some of us it was a new experience, and for all of us I think it had a lasting effect. And it's something we talk about regularly as a group, about being mindful or mindful. We've all got busy lives, we've all got busy work, different demands competing all the time. But what we've got to do is think about now, we look at the past, but be in the present of how we continue to influence the future. So that was really important there. So what we had to do was clear away our distractions, focus our attentions on ourselves and our influence on others. Because sometimes it's not just all about me, it's about the we. And that's what we did as a cohort. It was about we. So we had to look about where we've come from and where we're going to. You see, GOC, we like GOC. It was about stripping away the layers. It was about exposing ourselves, laying ourselves bare and asking ourselves really important questions about who we are. It taught us how to look good naked. And Ray is keeping his clothes on. Sorry. Sorry. So this is us. We are the South cohort. So what have we done? We've been a collective group. We're part of the 60 fellows, but importantly, we're part of a 20, our Southern cohort. That's important to us. We've grown stronger together. There's been a lot of goodwill. We've tried new things. We've supported each other outside of our fellowship and grown those networks of support. Both personally and professionally, we've been there for one another. We challenge each other. It's in a safe place. We can do that. And what sometimes is about taking the knocks. Some of us have started doing some work together. Some of us are working on some bits of work, some papers. Lots of us have got new jobs, like me. Thank you. But that's about where we've come to on our fellowship learning. We have grown as leaders, and it's a time of great change and also great opportunity, so we need to seize that. Looking at the word of where we come to at the end of our fellowship is the words of T.S. Eliot.
We shall not cease from exploration, and the end of all our exploring will be to arrive where we started and to know the place for the first time. Ultimately, this has been a journey of a destination to become better versions of ourselves. And that's not for better versions of ourselves for us. It's about clinical leadership. It's about transformational experiences with the end game about improving the services for the people we serve. As clinical fellows, we are today, we are tomorrow, and the services we provide will shine. Thank you.
Thank you both of you. Okay, next up a more personal account from Arma Sadfa, pharmacist from Guy's and St Thomas NHS Foundation Trust.
Okay, thank you very much. Firstly, I'd obviously like to thank the South Cohort, but in particular my own Action Learning Set, because my colleagues in my Action Learning Set have shared my journey with me. And I'd like to thank Chris Perrington from Sainsbury's, who I've been working collaboratively with for the last 6 months. What I intend to do is to describe my own very personal journey through this fellowship. I'm sure that most of you will have had the same experiences that I've had. It's just that I'd like to share with you what mine have been. My project has been working in collaboration with Sainsbury's, which is very obviously a private provider. So there are already issues with the public sector working with the private sector. So on day one, when I had turned up at the King's Fund in Mile End, I was absolutely terrified. I had no idea what to expect. My wife had gone overseas, so I dropped the kids off to school and then drove down to Lane End. I was the only pharmacist in the group. And as Ray's already said, when we looked at each other, when we went round and introduced each other, I thought, all these big people, what am I doing here? It was totally outside of my comfort zone. At the end of day one, we were doing our timelines, and there I was talking to people I'd never met before, telling them stuff which I'd never told people at work, very deep personal stuff. And they were sharing personal stuff with me as well, which for me was, right, I think we're beginning to get some sort of relationship here, some sort of trust going. Because as you all know, the first King's Fund, we were all outside of our comfort zones. For me, the acting thing with Toby from the theatre company, when we had to do those 30-second pitches, was really stressful, simply because I had no idea what my project was going to be. There I was, 30 seconds, to talk about a project which I knew nothing about. And then we had Nick White, I don't know where Nick is, telling me afterwards that you were lying. I said, Nick, I wasn't lying, I was making it up because I actually didn't know. But more importantly, on I think it was day two, we found out what our MBTI types were. I mean, I knew about MBTI, but I'd never experienced MBTI in the way that we experienced it in the King's Fund. And I think that was a starting point for my journey, was to identify myself, was to read the MBTI book and work out what sort of characteristics are described by my MBTI type, which pretty much describes me. I'm ENFJ, for the record. We left the King's Fund module, and we did the Action Learning Set, and then we went to Warwick. When I was at the Action Learning Set, our one was separate from the King's Fund, it was a few weeks afterwards. One of the things that was going on in my workplace was we knew that Sainsbury's had won the contract to provide our pharmacy services, but I was working alongside people who were on the front line, whose jobs were going to be affected by this transition, but they didn't necessarily know that. And I felt very uncomfortable working alongside people who were my friends. We shared jokes, we liked football, we talk about football every week, the last game at the weekend. And one of the things that Chris said to me was to think about authenticity, congruence, and integrity. So I looked into authenticity, and I wrote about it as a leadership style. I looked into integrity and thought, how am I maintaining my integrity, knowing things that are happening to people when they themselves don't know? But one thing I haven't been able to get over is congruence, and how does that work for me? We then went to Warwick, and in Warwick, we were put into our EBR groups. Now, everybody was allocated to the EBR groups, and they all had different experiences. I found that in my EBR group, we went through Tuckman's group stages in a matter of hours, rather than in normal group dynamics, you form a group and you go through the stages and it takes some time to do that. We went from the beginning to the end, I think it was about 6 hours total contact time. I found that incredibly disorientating, and I was totally traumatized by my impact on the group. I reflected on this a lot and thought, why was I behaving the way that I was? It was a bit like being in the Big Brother house. What's going on? The only trouble was I didn't really have much time to reflect, because the very next Monday we were back at the King's Fund. As I was reflecting, I thought about it, and then 3-4 months later when we did the leadership stuff, I learned that this was all about emotional intelligence. That is the process that I was going through. I've deliberately put up a picture of Mario Balotelli. For those of you who don't know who he is, he's a football player. He plays for Manchester City, which is a small club in Manchester. and he's not everyone's favourite person. The weekend after, we went to Les Mis in London, in the West End, and we spent some time with the theatre company. We went over to Mamma Mia and spent some time with the theatre company, and I'm sure you guys, my fellow colleagues, did the same thing. We learned about customer experience, but we also learned about customer experience in the real world, because we went to a restaurant prior to the show, and we got there really early. Yet, the food came late. Some people didn't get a chance to eat food. I know Ray, he was on my table. We were sharing food because Ray's dish didn't come. And in the end, we were literally running through streets of central London to make sure we get to this show on time. So we learned about the customer experience. We then experienced what I would call not great customer experience. And then we rolled straight in to Les Mis and watched a team work. We saw how they work. We saw when there was an interval. We learned about the reason behind this unexplained interval, and how the front of house staff came in, and how the paying spectators were not concerned about what was happening. There was a fire backstage, but they didn't know that. The next day, we had to share our experiences of teamwork with each other, which we did. We did a role play. And then we had an activity in the afternoon, which was a goldmine activity. Which again was a competitive activity. We turned it into a competition because we were put into 3 groups within our cohort. And the best team won. That was us. Because we worked as a team and nobody was necessarily in charge. We'd allocated roles. And what it showed to me was that this is how a team should work. There shouldn't be any prima donnas. It should be, this is your role, you're responsible for your activity, get on and do it. I want to share with you something about leadership glory, because it's London 2012 and I live not very far from the Olympics. This is Mo Farah, who everybody knows was the double gold winner for the 5,000 metres and the 10,000 metres. But he failed to qualify for Beijing. He didn't meet the qualifying times in the previous Olympics. He's now turned into an inspirational figure because not many people knew who Mo Farah was. He won the 5,000 metres, okay, he's got a gold medal, but how many people, when he was coming round the 10,000 metres, that final bend, were either at the venue or at the TV shouting out, go Mo, go Mo, even though he didn't know who he was. And the real test is, how many people did the Mobot when he crossed the finishing line, you know? And he's become a leader, and he's become an inspirational figure, although I don't imagine he set out to do that before the Olympics had started. The third King's Fund module was all about change, and we had the island activity, which I'm sure everybody has experienced. for me, this was, I was asked in a video shooting last week, you know, what was your light bulb moment? And I paused and I thought, I don't actually know what my light bulb moment was because there were so many. But this was a massive light bulb moment for me. And I know I shared it with my Action Learning Set group because we had the island for which the other group's island got destroyed. So they had to come to us. And what I learnt was that the other group had welcomed their visitors. I think you built an aeroplane landing strip on their island. They didn't think about whether they had an aeroplane or not, but they had the landing strip. We didn't do that. We were the group who created the ghetto. We felt afterwards, when we reflected on it, I personally felt really, really bad in terms of why did we do that, firstly? Why did our group of highly educated healthcare professionals who care for people have this groupthink mentality of, we will stick them in the ghetto? Now, not only did we do that, I was the one who drew the jail on the island. I suggested it, the others agreed. I put pen to paper and drew the jail. Now, why was that? And why was I allowed to do that? Why did I want to do that? Why did we treat the others in the way that we did? What I learned from that is maybe that's what we do. And certainly my work with Sainsbury's as a private provider, that sort of thinking has replicated itself within the workplace where the Sainsbury's guys are coming over, taking over our services, and we should otherize them. And why should we otherize them? They've got similar values to us, just a different company. We ended up calling it a reflection zone, but it's still a jail. Now, it didn't help that I was reading Lord of the Flies at the time. Now, on the learning set afterwards, one of my colleagues said that he doesn't read fiction books, so he doesn't learn anything from fiction or from books. And I was asked by Chris, what books are you reading? I thought, bloody, what's he talking about? What books am I reading? But when I went through the books that I had just read, I thought, there is a theme here, because I'd read a science fiction book, I'd read a book called Penal Colony, and I'd read a book called The Lord of the Flies, and it had a continuous theme. But this is the five leadership lessons from Star Trek, which you can learn from. Now, the last one, which was called Blowing Up the Enterprise. Now, when I first thought about it, I thought, well, what does that mean? But actually, in Star Trek 3, The Search for Spock, Captain James T. Kirk blows up the Starship Enterprise. Now, why does he do that? He's acting in the best interests of the Federation, and he's sacrificing the thing that he loves and holds very close and very dear. Maybe that's a lesson for us. Maybe we should spend some time living on the Klingon ship just to experience it. We then went on to the next King's Fund module. This is a picture of Oscar Pistorius, who at the time I put this presentation together was the poster boy for the Paralympics, until he got beaten by that Brazilian and he had a hissy fit about it. But it shows that he's being very persistent and he's able to cope with adversity. And that's a lesson for us. We need to keep trying. Even if we get rejections, even if we get people resisting change, we've got to carry on. There was one example when we went to Missenden, and a few of us went for a walk. And we just wandered along, thinking half an hour, we'll come back. Then we decided to take a shortcut through these woods. While we was in these woods, we had something what I would call a navigational failure. Now, as great leaders, we are not going to admit we were lost. We got to a point where we had to make a 50-50 decision. Do we go right or do we go left? We ended up going left, and we asked somebody, is this the right direction? And they said yes. So that just confirmed that we were good leaders. We knew what we were doing. The walk took an hour and a half as opposed to half an hour. But the key thing is that we all trusted each other. We had the wrong footwear for this wood walk because a lot of it was wet. And there was muddy ground, but there was a lot of trust in us. We then, within the King's Fund module number 4, we had the Jeremy Snape, the sports guy, come to talk to us. And he talked about Ubuntu, which is a South African philosophy, as quoted there. And this was a very important lesson for me, linking back to day one of our King Son module, where we talked about our timelines and where we'd come from and what were our emotional highs and lows throughout our journey. So for me, you know, I might be in a senior position, and hopefully I will be in a more senior position, but I must never forget where I've come from. And in terms of final thoughts, we've got to go back to the story of the wizard, or Wizard of Oz. Who was it who looked behind the curtain to identify the wizard? It was Toto the dog. Maybe what we need to do is to have no fear like Toto. Maybe we need to look behind the curtains. Maybe we need to look at these leaders and think, are you as powerful as you think you might be? And lastly, what have I learnt? Well, in the story, when Dorothy returns, Kansas was the same when she came back, but Dorothy had changed. So for me, my key learning point is that I don't want to go back to Kansas, and I'm not really bothered who the wizard is. I'm not looking for a wizard anymore. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Next up, Nick Jenkins, consultant in emergency medicine at Poole, and Sally Green-Smith, not Green, which was what I did yesterday, physiotherapist from Ashford and St Peter's Hospital NHS Foundation Trust with When Nick Met Sally.
Well, good afternoon, everybody. My name's Sally, and I'm a physiotherapist.
I'm Nick, and I'm an emergency physician from Poole. We'd like to share some more of our thoughts about the learning experience of the South cohort with you, and unsurprisingly, perhaps we've grouped them into the themes of brains, courage, and heart.
So to start with, brains. It's been fascinating to understand more about personality and behaviours and to see that leaders can all be so different and yet we can all be successful. We've all achieved our PG certs. We've used Myers-Briggs a lot during the fellowship and this next slide just shows you the 16 different MBTI types and they're represented here by some well-known historical faces. The statements underneath are epitaphs for each type, so I'll just give you a minute to find your own type and see whether the epitaph rings true.
Sally is an ESFJ and I'm an ENTP. What that means to an ENPT is that ENTP is that we're different. And that we work in different ways. And that's something we discovered as a cohort, that we got on so well as a group, partly because of our differences. And we enlisted the help of Claire, who's also an ESFJ, to produce a little film to try and show you how we worked slightly differently towards a Manchester-Birmingham assignment submission.
Can you see it?
Thank you.
Back. Okay, so there you go, we're different. So Nick and I, despite being from different professional backgrounds, have both faced challenges relating to culture within our organisations. And we've needed courage to overcome these.
Or endure them.
And we know that our experiences are not unique amongst the other fellows.
The fellowship programmes helped us to understand why we've encountered some of the difficulties on a personal level and on an organisational or cultural level. We have a better understanding, I have a better understanding of reflection and the benefits of reflection. I've been able to look back at our experiences and learn from them. I remember the first King's Fund module very clearly as well. I didn't really know what to expect, and I remember the dawning realization that we weren't about to be given the unfailing recipe for leadership, but rather that we were going on some kind of a journey, and probably I knew then a fairly terrifying journey, to explore ourselves and our behaviour.
The fellowship programme has helped us to develop our personal leadership skills and to understand how we fit within the culture of our teams and within our organisations as a whole. We've had the courage to arrange meetings with our chief executives and to tell senior managers about our projects. And certainly having the support of my sponsor and my divisional manager has helped me greatly throughout the fellowship.
Sally and I have both agreed that the fellowship has opened doors for us, but also that it's given us the courage to push through them. Several of our cohort certainly have new jobs, different jobs to the jobs that they were in when we started. I'm about to move trusts to a job where I hope there'll be a bigger leadership role for me.
And for me, I've made the courageous move of stepping out of my clinical role for a year. I've taken a secondment to our programme management office as a service improvement project manager. Stepping out of a clinical role after 20 years has been a brave and courageous move for me. But I believe that now is the right time for me to be doing this, and I hope that more opportunities as a clinical leader will be opened up as a result. As Richard Cox says on his Transformational Leaders website, it's so easy to play small and not contribute what you are here to give. It takes courage to get your voice heard and to have your leadership gifts recognised. But we trust that through this and future clinical fellowships, the unique gifts that we all possess will be developed and that we and our organisations will be transformed as a result.
We also want to acknowledge the emotional impact of the fellowship. I think we all fellows have probably experienced all of those emotions and some more. I think it would be fair to say that we all started the fellowship with some degree of fear or trepidation. Almost everyone who stood here this afternoon has said that. Should I really be here? What is everyone else thinking of me? Is my project good enough? And from our cohort's point of view, all credit to Donna and Chris for getting that all down on a flow chart on the first afternoon, flip chart up there. And before the end of day one, it felt like we'd developed a close, safe community of people who were already being open and honest with each other. And we have, and still do, and I think will carry on offering support to each other when it's needed. The action learning sets have also been mentioned as such important places for us to grow our ideas and ourselves and to develop along the fellowship journey.
And again, as already has been mentioned, there has also been a great degree of personal sacrifice along the line, with people spending time away from families, arranging cover for work, and putting in the hours necessary for completing the assignments. But I think that we all quickly realised what a privilege it was to be on this programme,
and we were prepared to give the commitment needed to get the most out of it. We now have the most wonderful support network, so thank you on behalf of all the fellows to the National Leadership Academy, the King's Fund, Manchester Business School, and HSMC at Birmingham for making this a most enjoyable, engaging, and life-changing programme.
And thank you to our fellow fellows. Thank you for being such an amazing bunch of individuals, for your openness and your honesty, for your love and support, which we very much hope will continue as we build on what we've only just begun. There's been a lot of talk through the fellowship about return on investment, and quite rightly so. What an investment. Our first class educational programmes, academic and experiential, our project funds, our residential sessions, our action learning sets, we've certainly not been part of anything other than a Rolls-Royce leadership development programme.
And we feel like we're just starting. This is the beginning and not the end. We've mentioned that a few of the fellows have begun to change direction already as a result of this fellowship. But we believe that there is so much more potential. In our group, we have clinical leaders now who will be leaders of the NHS in the future. Watch this space for 30 years and we'll show you the true return on your investment. We will maintain our links with each other, but the Academy needs to develop a long-term leadership alumni programme so that our true potential can be recognised. Thank you.
You have a seat and I'll stand up.
Okay, cool.
We have one more opportunity for asking a couple of questions if there are any in the audience. Over there.
I just wanted to say, as a sponsor, it's been an enormous privilege for me to sit here and listen to you sharing your experiences, some of them very, very personal. And I feel really inspired, and I shall go away and reflect on my own leadership behaviour, make sure I'm not getting a bit Christy old fart. And, but I think if you think of that power, that you could go and inspire other established leaders and get them, because we all... lose our way a little bit and become complacent. So a takeaway for you would be to go and challenge your leaders in the organisation and inspire them with your passion. Well done.
Thank you. Can we have the mic up? You've got one?
Thank you. It's Charlotte Allen from Oxford. I really did enjoy all your presentations and the reflections on your personal journeys. And I just wondered whether you had any further reflections about the direct impact on patients in terms of your service improvement.
I think for me it's about, you know, I've been working with Sainsbury's, which is a private provider. They view customer experience from a different perspective. Now, one thing I learned in the fellowship is that we don't necessarily view customer experience in the same way that we view patient experience. If we could overlap what we learned from the theatre companies in terms of the customer experience and valuing the customer and put that into patient experience. Because I think if we look at the NHS operating framework, patient experience equals what was the patient's experience within that certain admission or that contact with in terms of care. And certainly from my point of view, it's around medicines and medicine side effects. But actually customer experience is much more than that. It's when the patient walks into the hospital, what is that first contact? It's when they ring the hospital to book an appointment. How easy is it to do that, or how difficult is it to do that?
I think a really basic answer for me, and probably would be echoed by most of the fellows, if not all of us, is actually the reason why we're doing this in the first place isn't about us. It is about patient care. It is about improving services, and that's why we all came and signed up for this challenging journey. And so now it's taking it forward and making it happen.
My project was setting up a triaged pathway for physio-led services for low back pain.
using a validated tool, and people who score highly are on the Kiel Start Back tool are at high risk for chronic pain and dependency. Following NICE guidelines and the Kiel experience, we set up this group physio-led session with physiotherapy and cognitive behavioural therapy. And we've had two cohorts of patients come through this, and they've hated it because they didn't know what they were going to get. I went out and met a lot of GPs, and I said, this is what's going to happen. And basically, we set it up the way we said. The patients didn't get the right message. They had the wrong expectations. We got it wrong. So we need to start again.
Okay. Thank you. As Dorothy has learnt, we have learnt that surrounding yourself with good people is the key to success. The Wizard of Oz endures because it deeply resonates with our experience of the human condition. To be as best a human, a leader, we must draw from our heart, head, courage and spirit. Like Dorothy, we must seek to understand the needs of individuals in order to align our personal goals and organisational ones and facilitate individual capabilities to visualise ourselves and others in new ways. Monkeys, are you ready? Just when you think it can't get any worse, in come the flying monkeys. So deal with it. The world is full of lions and tigers and bears, oh my. Wise leaders keep their people moving down the yellow brick road, dealing with obstacles head on, staying true to their vision and mission, and always expecting to give back. It takes courage to challenge the status quo and stay on course. Change can be hard. It takes guts and perseverance to withstand resistance to do what is best for patients. It takes brains to achieve a patient-centred culture. You have to be willing to revamp processes that will impact on patient experience. You need to be able to spot best practice and learn from it. We need to foster a culture where patients take ownership of their own healthcare and are more equipped with self-management skills. Some things you simply have to experience for yourself. Leadership is one of them. Fellows and guests, as you return to the workplace, you bring with you confidence, purpose, and resilience. You have it in you. The next time you have the opportunity to exercise your wizardry, put on your ruby slippers, and find ways to enable people to achieve their potential. Take the journey, engage your brain, your heart, and courage. Leadership is much more than telling people to follow the yellow brick road. It's about authentically engaging them in the adventure. Remember, the dreams that you dare to dream really do come true. Thank you.